I don't know where the Cavs can go. I think they are in a tough, tough spot. No matter how much he insults me, it doesn't matter. I will give the man his due. I will listen when Stephen A. Smith tells us who wants to do what, where LeBron James might want to play a few years down the road, who might want to go to the Cavs. But let's just look at this before he does, at the situation the Cavaliers find themselves in. They are $28 million over the cap. All they can offer to anyone is the mid-level exception. So you're not going to get any kind of difference maker. You're certainly not going to get Paul George to take that kind of pay cut. You're not going to get any kind of difference maker to come in and do something that's actually going to swing the balance here where you can beat the Warriors. Secondly, and I'll listen to your answer on this, Stephen A., what kind of sales pitch is this? You have said it. Jalen Rose has said it, that LeBron James's relationship with Cleveland is more of a dating relationship than a marriage relationship. Not one that we can hold forever and ever, amen. Mm-hmm. So if LeBron is a free agent a year from now, and by the way, Kyrie and Kevin Love 2 years from now, what are you asking Paul George to sign up for? You asking for a year's more of this? A year's more of this team? That's a tough sales pitch. If LeBron flies the coop a year from now, and mm-hmm. I'll listen to you on what you have to say about that, mm-hmm. how bad would Paul George feel about picking the Cavaliers? And in the end, the last point is, even if you did it, traded Kevin Love, traded 2 years of Kevin Love for 1 year of George or something like that. Even if you managed to do it, would that really put you over the top for the Warriors? I don't think so.
Well, listen,
I think they're in a pickle.
Well, I will say this. Number one, most of us in the NBA community have heard that LeBron James is probably leaving after next season. Mm-hmm. The second he becomes a free agent next summer, he's going to look to be going out. But you're making the mistake of assuming that that's a reason why people wouldn't want to come. If you're Paul George and you want those dollars and you want an ideal situation, you might be willing, because remember, you're still under contract until next summer. So you might be willing to go there just to showcase yourself. And not only that, you don't believe you're going to lose if you have LeBron James and you are a star.
Time out. So you're saying what, in this scenario, Paul George signs up for something like the mid-level exception.
No, he's traded with Kevin Love to go
to the Cavaliers for one year of LeBron James.
I'm saying that's right, because after that, you can leave. You got to remember, he's still under contract. Paul George is not a free agent this summer. So what I'm saying to you is this. You're making the assumption that if you told Paul George, well, you don't have Kevin Love, but I have everybody else on the Cavs, and I'm with LeBron, we going to lose to the Golden State Warriors.
Right.
He don't believe that. You're making the assumption that Carmelo Anthony is thinking the same thing. He wouldn't believe that. When you look at a guy like Carmelo, who's about 32 years of age, understand that he's averaging 24, understand that at 6'8", 240, he can score inside or out. He's got a mid-range game, can shoot three-pointers, can hit shots from the free throw line. And they're looking at a guy like Kevin Love, who everybody respects and is a really nice guy, by the way, but in big moments in the finals, he hasn't shown up offensively. Last night, he shoots 2 of 10 from the field. He has a relatively pedestrian performance. Same thing in game 4. These are the kind of things that stars don't believe will happen to them. And so as I'm saying to you, we might be looking at it and saying, Golden State, who's going to compete with them? Those dudes are looking at it like, excuse me, you put me with LeBron and Kyrie? Hell yeah, I can. Okay. He might not have been able to, but I can. That's how they think.
Before you get two questions.
Sure.
Do you think Paul George over Kevin Love puts them over the Warriors?
I think, though, I'm not going that far because of Kevin Durant, but I will tell you this. I personally believe that if Paul George was playing on the Cavaliers, now I'm picking a 7-game series, and I mean it.
Well, you picked it this time, too. But
I said, I mean it.
No, but you mean it. All right. That's what I said.
I always said I mean it.
One last question. Would the Pacers make that deal? That's the other side of this equation. We talk about how you fix the Cavaliers.
Would the Pacers trade Paul George for Kevin Love? No, I don't think so. But if you know that you're about to lose him because he's going to walk out the door and you are in Indianapolis, you have to get some level of
Jimmy Butler might also be about. There are other excellent players who'd be available. Where do the Cavs go from here? Here's the problem. The Golden State Warriors are a big, fat roadblock for every team in the NBA right now. And the best GMs and the best franchises, like the Los Angeles Lakers, by the way, during the Michael Jordan era, did Jerry West chase his tail and wind up in salary cap, you know, hell because he's trying to beat Michael Jordan when it couldn't be done? No. What they did was they had a nice, fun team, won 48, 50 games, made the playoffs, very flexible with the salaries, and they were waiting for the opportunity as Jordan declined or left, and they identify, oh, Shaq's going to be a free agent. Let's just wait till that happens, go all in on Shaq. Oh, that dude Kobe Bryant's going to be a beast. Let's make sure we get him in the draft. The smart teams know when you're just chasing your tails and you wind up in second-round purgatory. Don't do that. Wait until the time is right. Stay flexible. Go all in on a potential championship squad. Here's the problem the Cavs face. LeBron James is such an amazing player. He just got one out of three against Golden State in the last 3 years. He very nearly took this to a six-game series with a supporting cast that simply wasn't as good. And if they somehow turn Kevin Love, let's say, into a Paul George, and they address rim protection, and they get a playmaker off the bench, look, Golden State fans, let's be honest. You are a superior team this year. When it was 5 points in the fourth quarter, palms getting sweaty? Anyone get? Because I remember thinking, oh, I think Golden State's going to win this. But it's a two-possession game in the fourth quarter, and Golden State is a clearly superior team. Well, what if that clear superiority shrinks a little bit? If you're Cleveland, you cannot fritter away the end of LeBron James' prime. You have to go all in and try to get a chip.
I think in the end, it's just they're in this pickle. I don't think Chicago's trading Jimmy Butler for Kevin Love. I don't think the Pacers are trading Paul George for Kevin Love. I don't think the deal they can find is out there for them. Maybe I'm a pessimist for what Dave Griffin can do, but I don't think the deal is out there for them to make that actually puts them over the top of the Golden State Warriors.
You're probably right based on the talent we're looking with Golden State, but I think that what we're really saying, without saying it, is something that everybody needs to recognize. You have an abundance of GMs out there who have gotten away with being so fixated on keeping their jobs that they neglect to do their jobs because they're not doing anything. They're not making any moves. And they're standing pat because they're saying, we're not going to beat the Warriors anyway. We're not going to beat LeBron anyway. Why do we need to make any moves? And as a result, they stand pat. They do close to nothing. And they keep their jobs. This is what we constantly talk about the players, and we constantly talk about the moves they make and they don't make, and we constantly talk about coaches, but we don't talk enough about executives who get away with doing nothing.